Table for 10, Master Mix. Table for 10.
Oh my All right, God.
Okay, go to Karen.
Yeah.
Go to Karen.
All right, buddy. Time to go for a ride, okay? We got you.
This one was left at Long County. Oh, no, this was Liberty Animal Control.
It's okay. It's all right. It's all right. It's fine. Yes, it is. It's all right. It's all right.
Love his freckles.
Foster mom for months is saying goodbye to her foster dog.
Hey, cat a whole mix, five.
Yeah, I've mastered cat a mixes. This can't be done.
Okay, should he make it? My guess is once he's healthy enough, if you could go, and then we'll figure out where he's going.
Yeah, he has a place to stay with us until he's ready to travel.
Then once he's ready to travel, either we'll try and hopefully beg fly to pause and have him fly up to Nashville, or maybe hopefully even beg a little more and I'll fly up to Nashville. Mm-hmm. Or I'll drive my ass down here and come pick him up.
Yeah.
Fingers crossed. I mean, he has a long way to go.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, I'd like to come to you again and thank you for the opportunity to come to you in prayer, Lord. Just like to come to you again and ask the safe travel of our friends and our loved ones, Lord, our family, extended family, Lord. And Lord, just be with them in each and every mile that they drive down this road, up that road, Lord, toward their journeys that they travel, Lord. And we just love and praise your holy son's name, Jesus. And all God's people said.
Amen.
Amen.
Featuring Poland, Ireland, Puerto Rico.
I would like to leave a message, I guess, for Dr. Kyle. This is Josh, and I have a little shelter dog named Asha. Asha, A-S-H-A. Well, we just brought him in, and he was near death on Thursday. They're giving him parvo treatments, and so we're just calling to check on him, see if he's still kicking. Oh. Yeah. Boy, he did, didn't he? Oh, did you? I appreciate that. Okay. I'll give her a call then. Okay. All right. Thanks, man. Bye. Well, he didn't make it through the night. He was just too sick. That's what happens when you... It's ridiculous. Folks, take better care of your animals.
The death of Asha made us angry. We did what was right and failed simply because somebody before us did what was wrong and succeeded. We thought about the places we'd been, the people we spoke with, and wondered if it was worth it, if it were even possible to make a difference. Then, after 18 hours on the road, we arrived in New Jersey completely unprepared for what greeted us. Hundreds of people were there in the cold drizzle. Their faces lit up with excitement in anticipation of these four-legged friends. It was inspiring. And it was time to fix it.
Well, that's funny. I like the terminology, how do we fix it? Because we need to fix it. So. Basically, our whole model is based on educating the next generation because I'm pushing 50. I am not going to fix it in my generation, but I can give my son, who's now 15, the education, resources, and awareness to empower him to make change in his world and his generation. We have to get into the school systems and we have to educate the kids. But we're not going to fix it in this generation. We're just going to give them the resources to do it.
I'm affiliated with Animal Aid because my mom founded the whole organization, and I founded the junior division of it.
How bright is the future of animal rescue?
It's as bright as we make it, because it's as bright as anybody makes it. Like, if we educate the future generation, the future of animal rescue looks like it's unstoppable. I mean, we can have zero shelters. That'd be amazing. But if we don't educate them, then I hope it'll probably be the way it is right now. I'm not gonna say it's gonna be like everybody's holding hands around the dinner table, but animals will be loved and they'll be in homes, and you know, they're not gonna be out in the cold. They're not gonna be out in the freezing. They're not gonna be in bad shelters. They're gonna be loved by, hopefully, by every family in America or everywhere else.
This is a tough question.
Okay.
Do you have a 5-year plan as an animal advocate?
A 5-year plan? Yes, right now I'm a freshman, so in 5 years I would love to be at the University of North Carolina studying at nonprofit business management degree, so I could successfully continue my mom's work with Animal Aid when, you know, hopefully it's a long time from now that she passes it on to me, but when she's done and she can't come to Georgia every 30 days anymore, she can put it on my shoulders and it'll be all fine.
What do you think is the biggest challenge?
Okay, but that's just unbelievable. You're awesome.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. He's trying to stay neutral. I'm like, what? That's just that's incredible. Yeah, that's awesome, man.
Thank you.
Good on you.
Good.
With the future of Karen's legacy safe in Matthew's hands, we turn to the present. A solution that, when done today, makes Matthew's work easier tomorrow.
I can't think of any reason not to spay and neuter your animal. It's gonna be really difficult for me to give you very many cons. I can't remember a single time that I've had an emergency situation where an animal comes in and the reason they're there is because they were spay and neutered when they were young. That doesn't happen. We have a lot of good old boys. We have a lot of gang members that come in with their pit bulls, and I treat everyone the same. I give them the same conversation, the same talk. I don't really care who you are. If you're a responsible pet owner and you love your animal, you will spay and neuter your animal. It is not macho to have huge testicles on your dog. That is not macho. It makes you look stupid. And you know, I think honesty is the best policy. But one of the saddest things that I have to do is to euthanize a 1-year-old Shih Tzu dog that they've bred to a, you know, I don't know, Cocker Spaniel, and she can't have the puppies and they can't afford to do the C-section. So that's a bad day for me at the practice.
The end overpopulation is going to require a lot of spay and neuter. We need to get less and less animals coming into shelters so that we can take better care of the ones that we have. And the primary ways we're taking care of that right now are transporting up north and spaying and neutering our animals so that we don't have more. But I was in Missouri for 6 years before I came here, and I was noticing a lot of change in Missouri. So the Midwest, things are changing in the north. It appears that the south, especially the southeast here, is much slower to change. And I'm not sure why that is, but it, in my opinion, things are moving a lot slower here. The change is happening, but it seems to be taking a lot longer. We joke that we're the only business that's trying to put ourselves out of business every day. Eventually, yes, I think it will happen, but I think we're a long way off, especially in the South, where that goal is still a long ways away, unfortunately. But it's coming, and there's a lot of people that are working towards it. But it's coming.
Spaying and neutering is one solution. But what about costs and availability? What about our neighbors here in the South and elsewhere who think they simply can't afford it? We asked Kate Pullen, Senior Director of ASPCA Outreach in their Asheville, North Carolina Training Center, what options are out there.
The ASPCA's new acquisition of the Humane Alliance, which has been a mainstay of Asheville for about 15 years now, maybe. And so agencies will come here and learn how the model works. They learn techniques for spay and neuter so that it's made quicker, more efficient. And they've learned about doing high volume so that they're not just spaying and neutering 6 animals a day, but they're spaying and neutering more like 35 or 40 animals a day and making a more of an impact in their community. It's a phenomenal program. program, we've been a part of it. The ASPCA has supported it for over 10 years, and now we're going to help continue to expand the services. They train veterinarians from around the country, and they train vet students from around the country. Over 500 of each have come through the program already. And the nice thing about it is they not only learn how to spay and neuter, they learn about why. Why is it important? It's important because we need to be not letting animals be born that there are no homes for. And so the veterinarians leave smarter on many levels. What we do know is that targeted, affordable spay and neuter in a community where the problems are and making that available to the community is critical. What we do know is that TNR for cats in the community is critical. But a mandate across the board actually doesn't solve the problem. And those other things that I talked about, the targeted, financially assisted spay and neuter and TNR do.
TNR, or trap neuter release, is an approach communities take to control their feral cat problems. As T. Fisher from the University of Tennessee's CATE program explains, a feral colony's health requires great care.
So we have a program here at the college called Feral Fixin', which is unique for us here at the university. It's a TNR program. It's anywhere from 70 to 85 volunteers, and we're able to help about 130 to 150 cats in a matter of 5 to 6 hours. They get a good physical exam. At that time, if we decided that they're just too sick or it's inhumane to put them back out, two veterinarians will agree and we'll euthanize those sick cats. Then they go and they get prepped and then they get tipped. And again, the ear tip is the universal sign that they've been spayed, neutered, and vaccinated at least once. So they trap them, they bring them to us, we give them all that they need. The caretakers then observe them for 24 to 48 hours before setting them back. Our caretakers know anytime that animals get dumped or wander into their colony, they call us. When those cats enter a shelter, it's a certain death. The shelter can't adopt a cat that's going to try to hurt you. That's not really good PR for the shelter. So again, our community vets see this as a way to help reduce those numbers so that they don't have to face that problem.
Oftentimes people want to spay and neuter, but they can't get the animal there, or it's not on the top 10 things of the things they need to get done that day or that week. And so by bringing it to the neighborhoods and making it affordable, you actually get an awful lot of people complying. And when we're talking about targeting, we're saying, where are your animals coming into your shelter from in your community? Take the program there and reach out to those people directly in their neighborhood and make it available to them, and you'll actually see a reduction of intake. That's the kind of numbers and success we're seeing, and that's exciting. We've all looked at New England as like the pinnacle. Look what they've done. They've solved the problem. They don't have as many animals in their shelters. They're actually importing animals from at-risk communities that are more rural or southern or lower socioeconomic communities, because they don't have them in their community anymore because they've been doing spay and neuter. But it's not been because of across-the-board mandates. It's because it's been made available to the citizens in those communities from way back when. I mean, when I was a kid, the New England communities were providing spay and neuter and the rest of the country wasn't. So if we talk about the general perception of animals in the United States, and oftentimes they are perceived as property. I can do whatever I want to do with my property. If I want to, you know, do X, Y, and Z, no one's going to stop me. That's why laws are so important. That's why legislation, to hold people accountable and to say they're not property, they're a sentient being, they have feelings and they feel pain, and we need to protect them. But the other thing is that sometimes regionally there's still sort of this feeling that an animal has to have a job. You know, it has to be a guard dog, it has to be a hunting dog, it has to have a job in order to stay in that home or be part of their environment. I think that we're on that track to change animals from being property through legislation, through education, and again, going back to the amount of knowledge that the public has about animal welfare is so much greater now because of the internet, because of the groups like the ASPCA, because of documentaries like this. People are smarter and they're starting to change that mindset.
We want to stop the cruelty at mass breeding facilities known as puppy mills, where dogs that are used to breed puppies for the pet trade are typically kept in small wire cages, stacked on top of one another for years on end, solely to produce these puppies for the pet trade. It's cruelty that just is completely uncalled for, and we feel we can do better as a society. We want to address this in many ways, first by educating the public not to purchase puppies without knowing where they're really coming from, and also by strengthening our nation's laws. We're trying to pass stronger laws, both at the federal and state level. Approximately half the states in the United States have some type of law regulating commercial breeding facilities, but at least 18 states have no laws whatsoever to protect these dogs. Well, we recommend that people who want to add a pet to their family always go to their local animal shelter first. You would be surprised the variety of animals you can find there. If you're looking for an animal for your family, you can find a puppy, you can find an older dog who's already been trained, who may already be accustomed to living with children or living with cats or whatever your family situation is. And you can find purebred dogs there as well if that's what you're interested in.
It is not Animal Rescue Corps' position to tell people what they're doing right or wrong. It's our position to do the work that we do and show people what's possible. Not only show them what's possible, but show them what's right. And I'm a big believer in that. I'm a big believer that people don't respond well to being told things, but they do respond well to seeing the right thing happen. The short-term plan is to put an end to puppy mills. I intend on seeing that long before my time has passed. And I think once we get started on that, once we're able to convince the lawmakers that this cruelty is unacceptable for our companion animals, I think they're gonna start to see that it's unacceptable for all animals.
Ending puppy mills will not be easy. Scotland Hazley knows that only through dedicating his life to this cause and through a shifting of mindsets will the nature of this industry change. And so we traveled north to find a glimmer of hope and one store's promise to be part of the greater solution.
There's obviously many different areas that we need to work on. Spay and neuter, adopting, and puppy mills was something that was especially important to me. Being in New York City, you're sort of bombarded with pet stores and dogs in windows. And I actually had my first dog from a pet store. And I always like to say I'm really glad that I had that experience of actually going in and buying a dog, because it was when I was a teenager and I didn't know better. And I would like to think that most people who do go and purchase dogs are not necessarily bad people, they just don't know better. And what we're able to do with Friends of Finn and the Humane Society is hopefully teach them where those dogs come from and what their other options are. I think that most people, if they knew where those dogs came from and what their options were as far as being able to go out and adopt a dog, they would hopefully make a different decision than going into a pet store and buying a dog. If we could get pet stores to replace their puppies, who obviously come from puppy mills, with puppies that we have rescued, I think that will hopefully eventually start to close puppy mills down.
How do we fix it? How do we make it better?
You know, everybody says that it's an impossible thing to fix. It's not really that difficult. The Humane Society of the United States, through Friends of Finn, is trying to end puppy mills in the United States. Animal Aid has teamed up with the Humane Society to transport puppies from shelters that unfortunately would be euthanized to pet stores. So now these pet stores are going to be able to adopt out puppies that in essence would have been killed versus buying puppies from puppy mills and supporting the puppy mill industry. So we believe that we're on our way to end the puppy mill industry by actually providing pet stores with puppies that come from shelters versus puppies that come from puppy mills. If people would just adopt rather than shop, the United States would actually be a no-kill nation. But the good news is, with social media, with films, with documentaries such as this, people become aware and they want to make a change. And you can't fault people for not making a change when they're not aware of it. But once you know about it, you want to help. So, you know, we're fortunate that the word's getting out there, the message is getting out there, and there is a solution. And within 10 years, I think the United States can be very different with dogs, cats, and animals.
Awareness, and also something to remember. Although there is much to be done, we are getting better, and the mindset is slowly changing. And then we remembered some sage advice provided by Pam Grier before we even set out on our journey. Possibly the most important tactic when trying to make the world a better place.
You take small steps, you still move forward. And that's what we're doing. And I constantly, it's a mantra to speak out, to let life is important, it's precious. Everyone here has a purpose. There's why is an animal, a well-bred animal, better accepted than a dog that's mixed breed? It shouldn't be. It's still miracles for, still miracles. Treat people with dignity, and they will treat the animals better.
We've identified what works. We know spay-neuter works. We know that addressing certain laws work. We know that penetrating puppy mills and dog fighters and hoarding works. So the more we continue to do that, and the more we get these issues in the living rooms of households throughout this country and beyond, the more we are influencing other people. Compassion is contagious.